Good morning, Paul, and good morning, everybody. I'm delighted to be joined today by the Chief Medical Officer, Professor Paul Kelly, and we're here to both update on the booster program and update on the implementation and bringing forward boosters to 4 months from the 4th of January on the basis of ATAGI advice, and to 3 months on the 31st of January, also following that advice. If I may, I'll indicate briefly an update on the program and then turn to Professor Kelly. In terms of the program, we've had 192,000 doses yesterday. So on the edge of Christmas, Australians have been coming forward, and I really want to thank them for that. And that includes 148,000 boosters yesterday. About 10 a.m. this morning, we will pass the 2 million booster mark. That's half a million ahead of schedule at this point in time. So Australians have been really fantastic in coming forward, and I want to thank them for that in particular. The second thing is that that will mean we've had about 1.3 million doses since the expansion of eligibility from 6 months to 5 months, just over a week and a half ago. And so that's really seen very high rates of vaccination. In fact, we're now at 42 million doses. We have passed 42 million doses, and all up, that means that we now have 94.1% first and 91% second. And at this point in time, as I say, this morning we'll pass the 2 million dose mark for boosters. So on all three fronts, Australians are exceeding expectations, and that's just a great tribute to our health workers, our medical workers, but above all else to all of those Australians who've come forward through all of the different channels, Commonwealth clinics, state clinics, GPs and pharmacies and Indigenous clinics. So thank you to everybody. In particular, I would note that as we've foreshadowed, ATAGI has been going through the constant review process of the international evidence, and Professor Kelly will speak to that. And on the basis of advice of the Australian Technical Advisory Group on Immunisation, it's no surprise we'll be bringing forward the eligibility for the booster dose to 4 months as of the 4th of January. The planning behind that is that will open up a new cohort. Currently, that means that we will go from about 3.2 million people who are eligible today to approximately 7.5 million who will be eligible as of the 4th of January. And that means that the cohort is expanded. It will be expanded again on the 31st of January to 3 months, and that will take it out to 16 million Australians who will be eligible at that point in time. And as we've said all along, eligibility is the beginning of access. It doesn't mean that somebody's overdue the very day they become eligible. These dates have been set out of an abundance of caution to give Australians early continued protection. And the advice we have is that the protection as it is very strong against severe illness, but what we'll see is a much stronger protection against transmission, and Professor Kelly again will set that out in more detail. The last element that I want to refer to, which follows the ATAGI advice, is that jurisdictions who believe that they have the capacity to bring forward any of these dates without displacing older and more eligible people in terms of those that have had a longer period between their second dose and the access to boosters should feel free to do so. As an example, I was speaking with the Premier of South Australia last night. He believes they have very strong capacity, and so ATAGI has given jurisdictions freedom to move forward with their state clinics prior to then if they have that capacity without displacing. And this is a very important principle, that the staged progressive program, as quickly as possible, is what we focused on, but focusing on the priority populations of the further someone has been, from their second dose, the more important it is that they're vaccinated. By acting at 4 months and then progressively at 3 months, we're giving the highest priority to those who have the greatest distance in time from having been vaccinated. And this also follows the age cohort because of the way in which the primary courses were delivered. So it's protecting the oldest and the immunocompromised and giving them priority as is appropriate. So I really want to thank ATAGI for their tireless work, the TGA, the Therapeutic Goods Administration, the Scientific and Technical Advisory Group, which has been led by Professor Murphy. So all of those groups have contributed to giving the government the ability to make this decision off the basis, on the back of what I believe is the strongest medical advice in the world. The last thing I want to do is to announce that the Council of Elders, 14 members, has been released today. The chair is Ian Yates, a very distinguished Australian, head of Council of the Aging. And there are, all, amongst those 14 members, five males, nine females. We have really strong female representation, very strong Indigenous representation, including, of course, Dr. Miriam Rose Ungamir Bauman, the Senior Australian of the Year, Professor Tom Karma, then other distinguished Australians such as Dr. Kay Patterson, former Health Minister, but also the Age Discrimination Commissioner, and Daniela Hiss, who is a leading author and academic and practitioner in relation to dementia care and management. So a really fine group of older Australians who stepped forward, and we're very blessed to be able to have their support and capability. Lastly, I want to wish everybody a strong Christmas. These are always challenging times, but when we look at this year, we have one of the lowest rates of loss of life in the world. We have one of the highest vaccination rates, and it continues to climb. 94.1% first doses, 91% second doses, and we've had one of the strongest economic recoveries with employment above what it was prior to the pandemic. So thank you to all Australians. Please keep coming forward for your boosters, and if you haven't had your first or second dose yet, it's more important than ever to have those doses. Professor Kelly?
Thank you, Minister. I might start with that point. So this is about the change in the booster program advice from ATAGI, but a real call out to anyone in Australia who is currently eligible for their primary doses, those first two doses, that this is still the most important component of protection. We've seen a rise in intensive care patients in New South Wales in recent days. Almost all of those have been unvaccinated, not even a first dose, let alone a booster. So that still remains the number one priority for the vaccination program. The changes today, as announced by the Minister on the basis of the ATAGI advice, I just would like to also join my voice to the Minister for thanking ATAGI for their work over the last week and indeed right throughout this process. It is very difficult making decisions as evidence is coming forward on a daily or even hourly basis. It is 4 weeks today since we found out about Omicron, this new variant of concern. And in those 4 weeks, we have already gained a lot of information, and in the recent days, even more information, particularly around severity and what is the effectiveness of vaccination programs around the world. So why has this announcement been made? There's two reasons to bring forward the booster dosing. The first one is as has been mentioned by the Minister, as has always been our main aim of the program, is to protect those that are most at risk of severe disease. So they remain our priority. Protecting people against severe disease remains our priority. The information we know, and as I say, it's been emerging only over the last few weeks about the protection of the vaccine, we know two key things. One is that there is a diminished but not completely, the protection does not completely disappear in relation to severe disease from the first two doses of the vaccine. It wanes over time, hence the time-based change in the boosters. The positive effect of that is that we do know now that boosters do protect and increase that protection against severe disease once that third dose is given, or a fourth dose in the case of immunocompromised people. So though that they are given, it's an absolute aim of the program to go forward and do that. But I will stress that just because you get to 3 months or 4 months or 5 months or 6 months, it doesn't mean that you immediately just that day lose your protection. That is not the case. It does decrease over time. It remains in place for severe infection, but it is diminished for Omicron compared with Delta. So that's the first point of the reason why we're bringing forward that booster program to 4 months from the 4th of January and 3 months later in, towards the end of January. The second reason is because boosters at this stage can help about the transmission of the virus, so the infection of people and with mostly mild or even asymptomatic disease, but they can then transmit it to other people. We know that, unfortunately, two doses does not change that ability to become infected a great deal. That, again, wanes over time, and there is a time-based process to that. But that protection against infection is diminished, again, in Omicron. That's quite clear. Again, with a booster, it goes back towards the same levels as Delta. It will be an important and is already becoming an important part of our control of the current Omicron wave in Australia.